I made myself one of these spinning bowl sanders, and because it was so simple to make it, I decided to make another one and take video of it. Let me just finish this bowl and I will show you.
You can find the link to the free downloadable plans in the description of this video. It will link you directly to the plans. From there you can download them or directly print them. The plans are made for an A4 page size, so you may have to adjust your printer settings.
The plans include pretty much every detail you need to build the sander, and if you have your smartphone on hand in the shop, you can just scan the QR code and it will bring you directly to this video.
I made myself one of these spinning bowl sanders, and because it was so simple to make it, I decided to make another one and take video.
You begin by cutting out two of the templates and glue them onto some 12mm birch plywood. Then you cut out the shapes roughly with about 3mm of overhang. Remove one of the templates and sand the surface lightly and then glue the two pieces together.
If you happen to have some thick plywood, you can use it, of course, but the thinner plywood is much easier to get. While the glue dries, I can work on the hourborn.
First thing to make here is the sanding pad. Draw a 50mm circle and another circle slightly smaller than the first one on some more plywood. Mark the center and cut out the circles a little oversized.
To be able to screw on the pad onto the hourborn, you need to embed a nut in between the two layers when you glue them together. So now I need to cut some holes that I can hammer this nut into.
I use a M8 nut, and the best size drill for that has 14mm. If you don't have that size drill bit, you can use a smaller one and chisel the whole hexagonal. Drill all the way through the smaller circle with a smaller bit. Hammer in the nut and glue the two pieces together.
The hub itself consists of a bolt, two bearings that you get from rollerblade wheels, some spacer pieces between the bearings, two nuts that get locked in front of the bearings, and a thick washer that acts as a flange. There are different kinds of washers. I would recommend the thicker one because it acts as a flange and so it has more stability.
When the glue is dry, punch the center and drill all the way through with a small bit to locate the center on the other side. Then with a Forstner bit with the size of the bearing, drill until you can sink the bearing a little beneath the surface. Do the same for the other side. Then with a bit smaller than the bearing, drill all the way through. Make sure to drill from both sides to prevent chip out. Then cut out the shape and sand to the line. A little bit of hand sanding is required too.
Next I have to drill this hole 12mm from the edge and also round over these corners. And therefore again cut out this template and glue it on here. Now this piece is finished and I can assemble it. The first bearing comes in from this side, the second bearing from this side, and then you lock it with a nut, but there is the space between the bearings and there should be some kind of spacer, because when you tighten up the nut here, you press the two inner rings from the bearings together and the bearings start to lock and won't turn. So you need to somehow have a spacer in there. You could use just washers. I found what works best are these split washers. So my spacing is a washer, then two of the split washers, and another normal washer, and then the other bearing. And then you can lock this together. You tighten it up until it doesn't wiggle back and forth anymore. And the second nut gets locked into the first nut. Now maybe the hole for the bearings is slightly too big and the bearing can wiggle around a little bit. And what you can do is to add a layer of tape around the bearings, and that should make them fit snugly. When the glue of the pad is dry, you can assemble it the first time. And you should tighten it up really hard, so the embedded nut gets pulled outwards and will stay there. To turn the pad round, I cut off the head of another bolt and lock two nuts on it. This gets chucked on the lathe, and with a washer it gets attached on this like on the actual arbor, and I can turn it round like this.
You should also turn and sand the front surface flat.
Next, we need to make the soft pad with the Velcro attached. For this one, I use this very dense foam. For this one, I want to have something softer. I have this foam. For gluing the foam onto the pad, you need some good foam glue. I would recommend EuPour. You normally don't find this kind of glue in hardware stores, but you should find it in model maker stores or online.
This glue gets applied on both sides and dries for about 10 minutes before you actually glue the two pieces together. Trimming the foam round can be a little tedious, depending on the foam you use.
Next we glue on the Velcro. Generally any kind of Velcro should work, but I really recommend to go with the high quality stuff. It will just last forever. I have a leftover scrap piece that's just big enough, and I still have it from building my drum sander. This stuff is not cheap, but definitely worth the money. This machine is about 1.5 years old, and the Velcro is pretty much like new.
I used the same glue as before to glue on the Velcro.
The basic sanding part is done. Now I need to make the handle. It doesn't need to have a specific size. You can make it as short or as long as you want. The only important thing is the front part. It needs to have the dimensions here.
I made mine out of a scrap piece of teak. Any wood will work here, but I recommend hardwood. Then transfer the dimensions from the plan onto the front part of the handle.
To prevent the handle from rocking back and forth during the cut, you probably need to shim it in the front.
Cut along these lines and they will give you the necessary cutout. The cut should be straight but not absolutely accurate. Then sand the cutout flat.
Next you need to drill the hole for the locking screw, and it's located 12 mm away from the front edge. The handle gets attached with a carriage bolt, and therefore you need to carve out a square section out of this piece to sink the carriage bolt into it. To allow the head to rotate, I now need to sand off these corners of the handle. And now with the front part rounded, you get the full motion. The sander itself is now finished. The last thing missing is the sandpaper. What you need are these hook and loop sanding discs, and they are available in every grid, and they are not that expensive. But it's actually much cheaper to cut them out yourself. Therefore, I need a hook and loop sandpaper roll. And this is the same roll that I use on my drum sander. I can just take one of the pre-made discs and trace around it.
Unfortunately, I could only find these rolls from 60 to 180 grit, so the higher grits I had to buy as pre-made discs. Cutting them out takes some time, but will save you a lot of money.
You maybe still wonder why you would need such a sander, or what are the advantages of it. Well, I will show you.
The essential advantage is that the sander starts to spin as you touch the wood. And because the sandpaper then is in continuous motion, it creates a random pattern of sanding marks. It's almost impossible to get nasty, deep sanding marks with this sander. With a 80 grit sandpaper, you can do some really heavy sanding with it. And if you want to be even more aggressive, you can power the sanding pad with a drill. That's great if you have to sand out some torn out grain. The other nice thing about it is that it clears the sanding dust really well. With just hand sanding, I found that I pretty often sand the sanding dust on the surface more than the actual surfaces. And the sandpaper clogs up very fast. Here the dust just flies away because of the spinning. That's especially noticeable in the very high grits. A 1000 grit paper clocks up very, very fast, but not with this sander. I also made a really dense pad with felt as the backer. It's perfect for sanding the outside, and for the inside I like to switch to a softer pad because it conforms to tight curves really well. I guess the result speaks for itself.
As you can see, these sanders do a really nice job, and they are super simple and super cheap to make. And if you make yourself multiple pads with a dense, a medium and a soft pad, you are prepared for almost every sanding job on bolts. You will find the link to the free plans in the video description, as well as some other links to online shops where I found the Velcro, sandpaper and some more stuff.